According to the Book of Mormon, ancient America was colonized about 589 BCE by a group of Jews from Jerusalem. After landing on the western shore of the land southward, which Joseph Smith and early Mormons identified as South America, these immigrants divided into two warring groups, the righteous Nephites and the wicked Lamanites, the latter of which were cursed with a dark skin to discourage intermarriage between members of the two groups. The Book of Mormon covers about 1,000 years of Nephite history, wherein they cycle through alternating periods of righteousness and wickedness. National ruin is repeatedly averted when the proud Nephites are brought to their knees through war with the savage Lamanites, causing them to repent and give heed to the prophets. In the end, the Nephites finally become so wicked that they are beyond redemption, and God allows the Lamanites to annihilate them in the 4th century CE in the land northward, near the eastern seaboard, in a region distinguished for its lakes and rivers. No one in Joseph Smith's day was in a position to question the Book of Mormon's historical claims. In fact, the general outline of Nephite history fits well with what was already believed about the Mound Builders, who had anciently inhabited the Americas and built the great temples and vast palaces discovered in Mexico and Central and South America, as well as the curious earthenworks in Central and Eastern United States. This mythical race, like the Nephites, were said to be white-skinned Christian agriculturalists, who were ultimately destroyed in the Great Lakes region by the savage ancestors of the American Indian.
Hi, I'm Dan Vogel. Thanks for joining me. In this video, I will explore in detail the once popular Mound Builder myth and explain why the Book of Mormon's version of ancient American history was both familiar and credible to first readers of the book.
Colonists to the New World were mystified by the discovery of the magnificent stone ruins in the jungles of Central and South America, as well as the abandoned earthworks of the Mississippi Valley and Great Lakes region. Such works contrasted sharply with what white settlers believed about Native Americans, whom they considered to be too uncivilized and lazy to have been responsible for their construction. It seemed obvious to them that another race, superior to the Indians, had once inhabited the Americas, which had either been run off or annihilated by the Indians in the Great Lakes region prior to the arrival of the British and European settlers. The Mound Builder myth thus grew out of the cultural and racial prejudices of its creators, and it should be no surprise that the myth reflected themselves and their troubled relationship with the Indians. Indeed, this fabled history was used to justify the cruel treatment Native Americans received at the hands of white colonists, who were trying to keep history, as they imagined it, from repeating itself. In contrast with French Jesuits who believed the Indians were noble men of nature, lacking only Christianity, the Puritans of New England held a harsh estimation of Native Americans. The Puritans were Calvinists and anti-primitivists, who not only believed that civilization was superior to the natural or primitive state, but also that Christian salvation was linked to civilization. When the Indians resisted Puritan efforts to Christianize and civilize them, Puritan accounts became increasingly unkind and pessimistic about Indian character. Some concluded the Indians were inherently savage and entirely incapable of civilization, and needed to be removed, either by death or forced exile. In his 1702 Magnalia Christi Americana, Puritan divine Cotton Mather declared that the Indians were doleful creatures and the veriest ruins of mankind, which are to be found anywhere upon the face of the earth. Though we know not when or how these Indians first became inhabitants of this mighty continent, he wrote, Yet we may guess that probably the devil decoyed those miserable savages hither, in the hopes that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ would never come here, to destroy or disturb his absolute empire over them. In another work, India Christiana, Mather concluded that their way of life was lamentably barbarous, and their religion, beyond all expression, dark. Even Roger Williams, otherwise a defender of Indian rights, was appalled by their hideous worships of creatures and devils. Those who portrayed the Indians as inherently savage, however, had to explain the existence of the earthen works of North America, as well as the great stone buildings and temples of Mexico and Peru. Many could only reconcile such contradictions by proposing that there simply must have once been a civilized, productive group in America in addition to the Indians. Jeremy Belknap, speaking to the Massachusetts Historical Society in 1792, articulated the theory this way. Mounds and fortifications of irregular construction were discovered in the thickest shades of the American forest, overgrown with trees of immense age, which are supposed to be not the first growth upon the spot, since the dereliction of its ancient possessors. The most obvious mode of solving the difficulty which arose in the curious mind on this occasion was by making inquiry of the natives, but the structures are too ancient for their tradition. Indeed, the form and materials of these works seem to indicate the existence of a race of men in a stage of improvement superior to those natives of whom we or our fathers have had any knowledge, who had different ideas of convenience and utility, who were more patient of labor, and better acquainted with the art of defense. At what remote period these works were erected and by whom, what became of their builders, whether they were driven away or destroyed by the more fierce and savage people, the Goths and Vandals of America, or Indians, or whether they voluntarily migrated to a distant region, and where that region is, are questions which at present cannot be satisfactorily answered. New York Governor DeWitt Clinton also believed ancient America was inhabited by two distinct groups. Interested in the Indian mounds of his state, he personally visited many of them and speculated about their origins at a meeting of the New York Historical Society in 1811. There is every reason to believe that previous to the occupancy of this country by the progenitors of the present nations of Indians, it was inhabited by a race of men much more populous and much further advanced in civilization. The numerous remains of ancient fortifications which are found in this country demonstrates a population far exceeding that of the Indians when this country was first settled. Clinton speculated that in ancient times, a large group from northern Asia migrated to America. Once in America, they built mighty cities and became numerous. In time, they were invaded and attacked by a more savage group, also from Asia, and eventually annihilated. And the fortifications, he concluded, are the only remaining monuments of these ancient and exterminated nations. John Yates and Joseph Moulton related an Indian legend in their 1824 History of New York, which seemed to corroborate such a theory. Before and after that remote period, when the ancestors of the Senecas sprung into existence, the country, especially about the lakes, was thickly inhabited by a race of civil, enterprising, and industrious people who were totally destroyed and whose improvements were taken possession of by the Senecas. Such sentiments found their way into newspaper accounts, even in the neighborhood where Joseph Smith grew up. In 1818, the Palmyra Register opined that the Mound Builders had made much greater advances in the arts of civilized life than any Indians, and the Palmyra Herald declared in 1823 that the fortifications were the work of some other people than the Indians. Not surprisingly, some believe these Mound Builders were a white-skinned race. Ethan Smith referred to James Adair's remark that the Indians have their tradition, that in the nation from which they originally came, all were of one color. The color, according to Smith, was white. As the Indians have brought down a tradition that their former ancestors, away in a distant region from which they came, were white. In 1816, the Philadelphia Portfolio reported that it is a very general opinion prevailing in the Western country that there is ample proof that the country in general was once inhabited by a civilized and agricultural people who were eventually destroyed by the Indians. It is a current opinion, the periodical continued, that the first inhabitants of the Western country were white people and therefore cannot be denominated Indians. One Indian tradition reportedly held Kentucky had once been inhabited by white people, but that they were exterminated by the Indians. In their 1824 History of New York, which was advertised in Joseph Smith's local newspaper, Yates and Moulton discuss at length that the mounds of fortifications in the Great Lakes region had been constructed by a white race, and that they had been destroyed by the Indians. After recounting stories of light-complexioned Indians still existing in Central and South America, they wrote, "An exterminating war appears to have taken place between the barbarous natives, perhaps under some Attila or Genseric, and their more refined civilized neighbors, ending in nearly the total destruction of the latter, the few survivors of whom fled to happier climes. And to these aboriginal whites, perhaps the Mexicans, etc., were indebted for their knowledge and refinement." Speaking of the earthen works of North America, Yates and Moulton state, "The traditions of other Indians ascribe the construction of these works to whites. Indians northwest of Ohio and others say that they had understood from their old men that it had been a tradition among their several nations that the Western country, and particularly Ohio and Kentucky, had once been inhabited by white people, but they were exterminated." In Sketches of Louisville and its Environs, published in 1819, Henry Murtry related the following. "If, then, there once existed in this country a people so far advanced in the arts of civilized life, as these relics indisputably prove to have been the case, the question very naturally arises, what has become of them? Hence arose a race of light-complexioned men, distinguished from their savage brethren, not more by a difference of color than by a refinement of intellect and a knowledge of the arts. About the time when General Clark first visited this country, an old Indian is said to have assured him that there was a tradition to this effect, that there had formerly existed a race of Indians whose complexion was lighter than that of the other natives, which caused them to be known by the name of white Indians, that bloody wars had always been waged between the two, but that at last the black Indians got the better of the others in a great battle fought at Clarksville, wherein all the latter were assembled, that the remnant of their army took refuge in Sandy Island, whither their successful and implacable enemies followed and put every individual to death." Late in the 19th century, the director of the Smithsonian's Bureau of Ethnology, John Wesley Powell, assessed the popularity of these beliefs, which by that time had been superseded. "It is difficult to exaggerate the prevalence of this romantic fallacy, or the force with which this hypothetic lost races had taken possession of the imaginations of men," he wrote. "For more than a century, the ghosts of a vanished nation have ambuscaded in the vast solitudes of the continent, and the forest-covered mounds have been usually regarded as the mysterious sepulchres of its kings and nobles. The Mound Builder myth thus made manageable for many Americans a complex of persistent problems with the Indians. Certainly, the archaeological record displayed evidence of what white settlers termed civilization, cities, temples, and fortifications. Yet Americans had come to justify their harsh behavior toward the Indians and taking their lands by talking about the Indians' inherent savagery and their inability to be civilized. The Mound Builder myth thus reconciled such contradictory ideas about the Indians. Given the negative estimation of Indian character common by the beginning of the 19th century, attempts by Ethan Smith and others to identify them with the lost 10 tribes of Israel have been described by one historian as part of a last-moment revivalist effort to find a secure place for the Indian in a civilized Christian world. The 10 tribe theorists tried to mitigate the view that the Indians were inherently savage. "The Indians are not savages. They are wild and savage in their habits, but possess great vigor of intellect and native talent, proclaimed Mordecai Noah in his 1825 speech on Indian origins. They are a brave and eloquent people, he said. The Reverend Ethan Smith of Pulteney, Vermont, shared Noah's sentiments. In his popular book, View of the Hebrews, published in 1823 and reprinted in 1825, he argued that the Indians had in fact become cruel and savage, but that it was because of their mistreatment by unprincipled whites, and that it was unfair to judge them by what they did in war. Yet, it is a fact, he said, that there are many excellent traits in their original character, such as might have been expected from the descendants of the ancient Israel of God. Certainly, Smith wrote, the Indians have deserved better treatment than they received from the whites. He pled with his fellow Americans, let them not become extinct before your eyes. Let them no longer roam in savage barbarism and death. By associating the Indians with the lost 10 tribes of Israel, Ethan Smith hoped to stop the Indian destruction and place a burden of responsibility on America for their conversion. This duty of Christianizing the natives of our land, even be they from whatever origin, is enforced from every evangelical consideration. If our natives be indeed from the tribes of Israel, American Christians may well feel that one great object of their inheritance here is that they may be the primary agency in restoring those lost sheep of the house of Israel. Thus, Ethan Smith defended the Indians against harsh judgments about their character and abilities by linking them with the lost tribes of Israel. According to Smith, these Jewish braves were no different than ancient Israelites, who also had lapsed into apostasy and idolatry. Far from being heathens or devil worshippers, Smith hoped to show that the Indians practiced a religion that retained many Judeo-Christian elements. Indeed, Smith and other advocates of the Lost Ten Tribe theory filled their books with parallels between Indian religion, culture, and languages, and that of the Jews. But the claim that Christianity had once been preached among the Indians anciently is most interesting in light of the Book of Mormon's scandalous claim that Jesus had visited America shortly after his resurrection in Palestine. The gospel had, in very remote times, already been preached in America, wrote Ethan Smith. It is a noted fact that there is a far greater analogy between much of the religion of the Indians and Christianity than between that of any other heathen nation on earth and Christianity. John Yates and Joseph Moulton, in their History of the State of New York, reported that a certain Indian tribe in Missouri was still retaining some ceremonies of the Christian worship. Ethan Smith even claimed the Indians believed in the Christian Trinity, basing his opinion on the discovery in one mound of what he called a triune vessel, a vase formed of three human faces said to represent Indian gods. But, argued the Reverend Smith, the triune vessel could be better interpreted as a representation of one Jehovah in three persons. The earliest Spanish explorers of Central and South America had also been looking for Christian parallels. Large stone crosses found in Central America, for example, were cited as evidence that Christianity had been preached in ancient America. Cortes reported seeing a stone cross 10 feet high near a temple in Mexico, which he promptly had destroyed to prevent the natives from worshiping it. The Indians, he reported, can never know the original, how the God of the cross came amongst them. There is no memory of any preaching of the gospel. Although the natives had no memory of Christianity, the stone crosses, according to early writer Francisco Clavijero, proved to many that the gospel had been preached in America some centuries before the arrival of the Spaniards. Antonio del Rio included in his 1822 book a plate showing an engraving of a Mayan offering sacrifice to one of these stone crosses. Actually, these so-called crosses are stylized or conventionalized world trees, a central element in the religious worship of the Aztec and Maya, who believed that such trees were placed at the four cardinal points and another in the center. A belief that Christianity had existed in the New World led naturally to questions about how the gospel could have been preached to the ancient Americans. In 1792, Jeremy Belknap phrased the question this way: if the gospel be designed for a universal benefit to mankind, why was it not brought by the apostles to America? To solve this difficulty, it has been alleged that America was known to the ancients, and that it was enlightened by the personal ministry of the apostles. Congregational clergyman Samuel Mather argued in 1773 that Christ had commissioned his apostles to go into all the world to preach the gospel, and that the apostle Paul had declared that the gospel had been preached to every creature under heaven. Therefore, there were good reasons for believing that the gospel had been preached to the ancient Americans. Mather himself believed that the apostles and perhaps some of the 70 disciples might have visited America and preached the gospel. Although the Indians of this Western world sinned away the gospel, Mather hoped that through his preaching they would one day be restored to the true Christian faith. Early Spanish explorers and priests also promoted the story that the apostles once came to America to preach the gospel. Speculation about an apostolic visit to ancient America seemed to find support when it was discovered that the Mexican god Quetzalcoatl and two other deities of Central and South America were, as described by James H. McCullough in his 1817 book Researches on America, men who appeared on a sudden with white skins, long beards, and flowing garments. Some identified Quetzalcoatl with the Apostle Thomas. Francisco Clavijero, who personally doubted the story of St. Thomas's visit to America, wrote, "Dr. Sanguenza imagined that Quetzalcoatl, deified by these people, the Mexicans, was no other than the Apostle St. Thomas, who announced to them the gospel. Some Mexican writers are persuaded that the gospel had been preached in America some centuries before the arrival of the Spaniards. The grounds of that opinion are some crosses which have been found at different times, which seem to have been made before the arrival of the Spaniards. The fast of 40 days observed by the people of the New World, the tradition of the future arrival of strange people with beards, and the prints of human feet impressed upon some stones, which are supposed to be the footsteps of the Apostle St. Thomas. The legend of St. Thomas's visit to America was repeated by others, but the legend of Quetzalcoatl was open to interpretation. At least one early writer, Chevalier Bottarini, found the legend of Quetzalcoatl more suggestive of Christ himself. Ethan Smith was also fascinated by Quetzalcoatl, whom he said was the most mysterious being of the whole Mexican mythology, but he was equivocal on his identification. Smith described him as a white and bearded man, and as both a high priest and legislator, which seemed to Smith to combine the tradition of Moses the lawgiver and Aaron the high priest. In reality, the legend of the ancient god Quetzalcoatl, symbolized by a feathered serpent, was conflated by the Indians with a story of a 10th century CE ruler named Topiltzin, who reportedly had fair skin and a beard. He had left his people under embarrassing circumstances, promising one day to return. While the Quetzalcoatl legend has long been exploited by Mormon missionaries as evidence in support of the Book of Mormon's account of the resurrected Jesus preaching to the ancient Nephites, it is important to keep in mind that it was well known before the Book of Mormon appeared. When Ethan Smith combined the Lost Ten Tribe theory with the Mound Builder myth, he was forced to modify the existing theory to accommodate the passage in 2 Esdras 13:41, which declared that the lost tribes had gone to a land where never mankind dwelt. This condition could not be met if the ancestors of the Indians had come to a land where the Mound Builders already existed. Rather than having separate migrations for Indians and Mound Builders, Smith had one migration to ancient America, explaining that the Indians had separated from the more civilized tribes, resorted to hunting, and eventually degenerated into wild savages. In time, he speculated, the Indians destroyed their more civilized, peaceful brethren somewhere in North America. This theme is repeated several times in his 1825 book. Israel brought into this new continent a considerable degree of civilization, and the better part of them long labored to maintain it. But others fell into the hunting and consequent savage state, whose barbarous hordes invaded their more civilized brethren, and eventually annihilated most of them and all in these northern regions. But the savage tribes prevailed, and in time their savage jealousies and rage annihilated their more civilized brethren. It is highly probable that the more civilized part of the tribes of Israel, after they settled in America, became wholly separated from the hunting and savage tribes of their brethren, that the latter lost the knowledge of their having descended from the same family with themselves, that the more civilized part continued for many centuries, that tremendous wars were frequent between them and their savage brethren, till the former became extinct. No other hypothesis occurs to mind which appears by any means so probable. Although Joseph Smith's Nephites were not from the northern kingdom of Israel, or part of the Lost Ten Tribes, the Book of Mormon follows the Reverend Ethan Smith's theory of having a single origin for both Mound Builders and Indians. According to the Book of Mormon, shortly after Lehi's family arrived in the New World from Jerusalem, Lehi died and his colony divided into two major groups. The civilized, peaceful group, called Nephites, after Lehi's righteous son Nephi, built cities, worked metals, kept records, tilled the earth, managed flocks, and wore clothing. The uncivilized group, called Lamanites, after Lehi's oldest and rebellious son Laman, lived in tents, hunted, went virtually naked, and were savage warriors. The Book of Mormon's description of the Lamanites sounds like an exaggerated version of contemporary stereotypes about North American Indians. After their separation from the Nephites, the Lamanites were led by their evil nature to become wild and ferocious and a bloodthirsty people full of idolatry and filthiness, feeding upon beasts of prey, dwelling in tents, and wandering about in the wilderness with a short skin girdle about their loins and their heads shaven. And their skill was in the bow, and in the scimitar, and in the axe, and many of them did eat nothing save it was raw meat. Thus, in the Book of Mormon, the savage group descended from the civilized one, just as in Ethan Smith's theory. Proponents of the Indian Israelite theory had to explain the change in the Indian's skin color. While some skeptics argued that the Indian's skin color, like that of Asians and Africans, was evidence that they had not descended from Adam, others argued that the change in skin color was due to climatic and environmental conditions. Traveler James Adair, for example, wrote in 1775, "Many incidents and observations lead me to believe that the Indian color is not natural, but that the external difference between them and the whites proceeds entirely from their custom and method of living, and not from any inherent spring of nature. That the Indian color is merely accidental or artificial appears pretty evident." Adair believed that the years of exposing their bodies to parching winds and hot sunbeams had tarnished their skin with a tawny red color. If the Indians' ancestors had also persisted in painting their skin and exposing their bodies to the sun, Adair speculated that nature might have effected a permanent change. We may easily conclude, then, what a fixed change of color such a constant method of life would produce. For the color being once thoroughly established, nature would, as it were, forget herself, not to beget her own likeness. Adair therefore found it reasonable to assume that the Indians' ancestors, due to climatic and environmental conditions, gave birth to dark-skinned children. The Book of Mormon gave a different solution. The Nephites were described as a white and delightsome people, but the Lord eventually cursed the Lamanites with a skin of blackness for their wickedness. Shortly after the Nephites and Lamanites separated, Nephi states that the Lord caused the cursing to come upon them, yea, even a sore cursing, because of their iniquity. Wherefore, as they were white and exceeding fair and delightsome, that they might not be enticing unto my people, the Lord did cause a skin of blackness to come upon them. And cursed shall be the seed of him that mixeth with their seed, for they shall be cursed even with the same cursing. Thus, the Book of Mormon explains how a people of Jewish descent became dark-complexioned. The Nephites were continually harassed by the Lamanites until late in the 4th century CE, when the Nephites were driven by the Lamanites into the land northward, where, like the Mound Builders, they were destroyed in a region described as having large bodies of water and many waters, rivers, and fountains. With a burial mound in nearly every cornfield, or so it seemed to Joseph Smith's contemporaries, The Book of Mormon's warning to Jacksonian America, "Repent or be destroyed," was extremely plausible. What happened once could happen again. If America remained unrepentant, Mormon warned, God would unleash the Indians upon them and destroy them, just as the Lamanites had destroyed the Nephites. As Mormon prepared his people for their last stand against the Lamanites on the Hill Cumorah, which Joseph Smith and early Mormons located in western New York, he warned Latter-day American Gentiles to repent and humble yourselves before God, lest he shall come out in justice against you, lest a remnant of the seed of Jacob, the Indians, shall go forth among you as a lion and tear you in pieces, and there is none to deliver. While such a threat no longer seems plausible, Joseph Smith dictated this passage at a time when the fear of Indian uprisings loomed large in the minds of Smith's contemporaries. In this way, the design of the Book of Mormon was really quite clever. However, within 2 years, Congress passed the Indian Removal Act, which gave U.S. troops authority to banish Native Americans from their homelands and relocate them in the territory west of Missouri. This process culminated in the removal of the Cherokee in the so-called Trail of Tears in 1838 and 1839. Though the Book of Mormon is perhaps harsher than Ethan Smith in its judgment of the Indians, using such adjectives as wild, ferocious, bloodthirsty, filthy, idle, loathsome, abominable, and drunken, it shares his enthusiasm for Christianizing the Indians. The title page of the Book of Mormon states that its purpose is to show the Lamanite Indians what great things the Lord hath done for their fathers, and that they may know the covenants of the Lord, that they are not cast off forever, and to convince them and the Gentiles that Jesus is the Christ. In July 1828, Joseph Smith dictated a revelation that explained, "And for this very purpose are these plates preserved, that the Lamanites or Indians might come to the knowledge of their fathers, and that they might know the promises of the Lord, and that they may believe the gospel." The Book of Mormon's historical claims may seem bizarre to us, but it was written at a time when it made perfect sense. However, the Mound Builder myth began to wane in the latter half of the 19th century. By 1890, Smithsonian's John Wesley Powell could finally write, "The spade and pick in the hands of patient and sagacious investigators have every year brought to light facts tending more and more strongly to prove that the mounds, which have excited so much curiosity and become the subject of so many hypotheses, were constructed by the historic Indians of our land and their lineal ancestors."
The Book of Mormon's obvious similarity to the Mound Builder myth and its subsequent demise is a serious challenge to the book's historical claims. The situation is such that we really do not need to invent limited geographies or speculate about how the Nephites might have fit in with Mayan history. The Nephites, like the mythical white-skinned Christian Mound Builders, have simply vanished. And the ruins of Central and South America and the earthenworks of North America have been rightly credited to Native Americans from Asia. I'm Dan Vogel. Thanks for watching.